Jenny's first claim that it will lower HIV. Persons who exchange sex may use condoms less often with regular clients than one-time clients, and even less frequently with intimate partners, which could lead to increased HIV and STDs. Unequal power in a relationship with clients may also make it difficult for persons who exchange sex to negotiate condom use, and persons who do exchange sex may receive more money for sex without condom use, meaning that increased HIV and STDs is a serious possibility. Many persons who exchange sex may not know of their HIV status because they do not know where to access available information, or are just uncomfortable with sharing about sexual and substance abuse histories. Lastly, persons who exchange sex, if they're under the influence of alcohol or drugs, may have impaired judgment, engage in riskier forms of sex, and have difficulty negotiating safer sex. Her second claim that it will decrease violence. Women who bring charges against pimps and clients will have to bear the burden of proving that they were forced in court. And how possibly can a prostitute prove that she was forced to become a victim of sexual violence if this has happened to her in her recruitment or as part of her working conditions, if it's the nature of the sex industry? Women in a sauna prostitution, for example, have even less control over what services they will perform. On the street, very few women will do certain sexual acts without a condom, but in the saunas, owners who obviously don't want their customers to leave will get to choose what sex workers do, and with or without a condom. While sex trafficking implies force, fraud, or coercion, it may not be easy for either consumers or law enforcement to distinguish individuals who are selling sex with their consent and with those who are not. 47% of women in the U.S. prostitution stated that men expected sex without a condom, and 73% reported that men offered to pay more for sex without a condom. 45% of women said that men became abusive if they insisted that they use condoms. Lastly, prostitution is just downright degrading to women. Normalizing the act of buying sex debases men by assuming that they are entitled to access women's bodies for sexual exploitation. And sexual gratification. If paying for sex is normalized, every young boy will learn that women and girls are commodities to be bought and sold. Rather than consenting to prostitution, a prostituted woman more accurately complies with the extremely limited options available to her. Her compliance is required by the fact of having to adapt to conditions of inequality that are set up by the customers who pay her to do what he wants to do. And prostitution, although seeming a choice, it's highly not a choice. And most women and girls do not choose to enter the sex industry. Research indicates that for the vast majority of women, it is a highly constrained choice. Viewing prostitution as a genuine choice for women, such as secretarial work or waitressing, diminishes the possibility of women getting out and improving their lives. 92% of women prostitutes say that they want to leave prostitution but can't due to the lack of money or food. The legalization may actually drive some women into street prostitution. Arguing against an Italian proposal for legalized prostitution, Agosti has suggested that brothels actually deprive women of what little protection they may have on the street, containing women to closed spaces where they have little chance of meeting outreach workers or others who might help them exit prostitution. And lastly, because they must register to lose their anonymity, women are more vulnerable to being stigmatized as sex workers, and this identity follows them everywhere. Thus, the majority of women in prostitution still operate illegally and under.